On today's show,
it's Friday night and we feel all right as we get you set for game four of the NBA Finals.
Will Kevin Love play? Should Kerr start Iguodala? And will this guy get his first burn?
And inspired by LeBron's Kiss the Sky oop, we count down the top 10 dunks of the playoffs.
It's Friday, June 10th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us live on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're happy to have all of you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Millis.
Yeah!
To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lele.
Lele, and last, certainly not least, joining us live in Cleveland, it's Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o!
TK, yesterday we showed a clip of you getting Cavs fans to give a little LeBron doll a pep talk before game three. Now, obviously it worked. LeBron had his best game of the series, and Cleveland got the win. So I can only assume that you've been walking around and taking all the credit for the Cavs game three win. Is that true?
Well, Skeets, I can't take all the credit. I'll only take 25% of it. So 25% to me for making it happen, 25% to the fans for the pep talk, 25% to Stuff LeBron for hearing all that tough talk, and, you know, 25% to actual LeBron for playing in the game and being everywhere. But you guys know I love these dolls. Love to bring one home to my daughter every time I go somewhere. So I went down to the team store today, and that's where I found the Kevin Love doll. And I had to get it because I think when I bring it home to Isla, she's going to think that it's her dad.
Wow.
The resemblance is uncanny. I mean, the guy's even got blue eyes. I don't know. Maybe I'll have to chop off the James Harden beard she's got at home and put it on his face to make it more accurate. But I don't know. Pretty close.
I don't remember Kevin Love having hair like that, really.
Yeah, I don't really either. But, you know, he's gone through a couple of different looks this year. So maybe at some point we missed it. I don't know. It looks good on him, though.
All right. Good stuff. I'm glad your daughter is accumulating all of these dolls. We'll talk to TK a little bit later in the show. But yeah, game four, NBA Finals between the Warriors and Cavs. Tonight, 9 p.m. Eastern on ABC. It's a Friday night game. It's so weird. Can LeBron and the Cavs even up this series, or can the Splash Brothers finally make it rain and send this thing back to the Bay up 3-1? We got some key questions here as we get ready for game four tonight. The first one, we are still, right now, live here on the air, waiting to find out whether or not Kevin Love is actually even cleared to play in the game.
Right.
A lot of reports say he is going to be cleared, so let's go with that assumption. And the question to you is, if he is and he's good to go, do you think the Cavs should start Kevin Love tonight?
I think Tyronn Lue has got to start Richard Jefferson, because you got to figure this game's going to be a little bit closer than game three. And when it does get to that point, if I'm Tyronn Lue, I want my guys to look at each other and say, listen, we did this in game three, and have that continuity and that camaraderie in the back of their mind that RJ in the starting lineup helped us win. To me, that value outweighs everything that is in Kevin Love's talented body. I would start Richard Jefferson in game four.
I'm still of the belief you start your best players, especially when the guy like Kevin Love isn't a specialized bench player and he's going to have to come in and play a different role than he's normally used to. And again, he only missed one game. I know it's a serious injury anytime you get hit in the head. Sure. But if he's cleared to play, like they guess your best lineup out there, get him some touches early, get him involved. Try to get that sort of feeling that they had in game three into game four and get him some shots early on.
Is it not a little, though, redundant having Love out there in the starting lineup? Because you have almost then too much scoring. You got LeBron, you got Kyrie. Why not bring a guy like Kevin Love off the bench and maybe he shines with the second unit?
Yeah, well, I think that's a legitimate question. And I think you say, yeah, it's only one game and this is their best lineup, but it's 4 days off.
Mm-hmm.
Does he come out firing and playing great right out the gate? You just can't take any chances this time of year. And you saw 2 days ago your success, your only success in this series. I wouldn't take any chances if I'm Tyronn Lue.
When you say, though, maybe bring him off the second unit to sort of spark something there and maybe get some baskets, he's just not used to playing that role. He's used to starting. He's used to getting touches early. I think that's the better role for him. And also, even though Jefferson took his place in the starting lineup, LeBron really played his position there going to the four anyway. So it's a little bit of a confusing situation that Jefferson came in and took Love's spot because he didn't really do that. So for me, go with your best players from the start, especially if they're starters, and then hopefully Richard Jefferson can bring that punch to the second unit.
All right, we'll find out hopefully soon enough, maybe even while we're live on the air here, whether or not Kevin Love's good to go and whether he's even starting. Let's move on, though. Let's flip it, look at the Warriors side of things here. Will the Warriors sit Andrew Bogut and go small, especially if the Cavs stick with Richard Jefferson? What do you think?
I don't think Steve Kerr goes to the death lineup right away. That lineup, to me, is a break glass in case of emergency, and it's not an emergency quite yet. Last year, Steve Kerr started Iguodala when they were down 2-1 and in the last series in the seventh game. I don't think he wants to instill in his guys that this is an emergency situation. Right. There's no need to panic. I think last game, he just attributes it to a bad game, entirely just a bad game, and the guys will come off the bench within minutes. He'll be quick to pull Andre Iguodala off the bench if things don't go well the first 2 minutes. I just don't think it's time to panic quite yet, although we know the death lineup is amazing, fantastic. I just don't think he wants to instill that in his guys that it's a pressure situation quite yet.
Yeah, the pressure's on Cleveland tonight. Let's not forget that, because if they lose that, their series is going to be very, very difficult to win. So I think Steve Kerr wants to say, I'm not going to play all my cards from the start. I'm going to go with Andrew Bogut. He's been good for us in the first two games, not so good in game three. I can pull that trigger anytime I want, maybe 2 minutes into the game if it's not working or if he gets in foul trouble. I think Steve Kerr says, you know what, let's just see what they do first. Maybe they do start Kevin Love or Richard Jefferson, and maybe that dictates what we do. But I think he will stick with Andrew Bogut, because I just think that's the best way for him to play, and then can use that death lineup whenever he wants.
Sure. Moving on here, guys. There's been a lot of talk about Steph Curry and Klay Thompson struggling in this finals here. Is there anything that the Warriors can do to get these two guys, one or both of them, going? Is there anything you're seeing?
I'm not worried, to be honest. The last two games, Steph Curry has quietly shot over 50%. It's been quiet, but he's been 13 for 24. He also had, in game two, 19 points in 24 minutes. Because of foul trouble. So I don't think we'd be talking about him differently if he didn't get into foul trouble. Extrapolate that. It's about a 27-28 point game. There's nothing to worry about, in my opinion. He had a terrible game in game three. The entire team had a terrible game. The shots are coming. Yeah, they're not going down, but there's just no need to panic quite yet. They're still up 2-1, big picture.
The shots look bad when they miss them, but we've seen that all season long. They do sometimes take some shots that no one else in the league really should be taking, and they just haven't dropped. A couple of those, if they drop early on tonight, I think it's a whole different story. I think if the Warriors get out to a good start, it changes the whole way.
They need to not worry about whether those deep threes and challenge threes drop, though. I think, and we've heard them talk about this over the last couple of days, they want to attack. I mean, the Cavs are doing a great job. They're switching because they're going small, doing what the Warriors do when they go to the small lineup. They switch everybody, and then they run them off the three-point line. And Clay and Curry are forcing things because they're out there. Attack. These guys can attack the rim and either finish inside, because there's no rim protection when Tristan Thompson is your only big in there and LeBron's out there doing all the switching, or find other guys, shooters in the corner. I think they just need to be more aggressive getting into the paint, and they both can do that. Mm-hmm. Clay has improved over years, and we know Curry can do that.
Well, they both do it, and they've both done it the entire season. Right. When they've had bad three-point shooting nights, they still win games. They're still 73-9. Does the jump shot go from time to time? Of course, but they still win games because they do that. Mm-hmm. But this entire narrative about Steph really stinking, again, he's shot 13 of 24 the last two games. It's just that he hasn't put up a 30-point game because of foul trouble and because his team really stunk last game.
Yeah,
he had a 13-point third quarter. 13 points in the third quarter. It was just in a blowout because his team stunk. I don't think he's that bad. 54%, 18.5 points the last two games. That's pretty darn good for 90% of the players in the NBA.
The shooting may not be bad, but he was horrible defensively. We talked about this after
the
game.
He wasn't contributing.
And he's been sloppy with the basketball. Yeah. So more than anything, maybe even more than the shots falling, the threes falling, is getting back to playing good defense, keeping Kyrie in front of you, don't get cut back door by the Cavs, and stop turning the ball over.
Steve Kerr addressed that, though, as well. He said Steph understands that when he plays well, he's going to get a lot of praise, but when he hasn't had a good game, in the finals especially, you're going to get a lot of criticism, and he thinks he's ready to handle all that.
I just think the entire team will be ready. 13-1 after a loss this season. That blowout is going to get them going. We know that, and Steph's going to be a part of that. I'm really, really pumped for game four.
All right, well, next question here. It's pretty simple. Who is tonight's biggest X factor? Who or what is the X factor to you?
Kyrie Irving, for me, is actually an X factor because I really liked what he did in game three in that first quarter. He was aggressive, he took the initiative, and he didn't say, well, I'm going to wait for LeBron to dictate terms. He went out there, and part of the reason perhaps Steph struggled is Kyrie went at him and made him work hard defensively. And Kyrie Irving is such a good player because he can shoot, he can get inside and get to the free throw line, and he can make the right pass as well. So I think he has to come out with exactly the same mindset he had in game three. Be aggressive. Doesn't have to hit every single shot, but just make sure that he's making defenders work on him.
I like Kyrie. I think the X factor, not the particular player, but actually one specific skill set of his, is whether LeBron has found his lost jump shot. That was the best shooting in a long time from outside the paint in game three that we've seen from Bron. It was the first time in nearly 16 months that he shot over 50% from the floor against the Warriors. He was good. I mean, he made more shots outside the paint in the third quarter of Game 3 than he had made in the entire series before that. You know, 4 of 8 on the jumpers of 15 feet or plus. That changes how the Warriors have to play him. Yep. If he has a little more confidence in that and he can knock him down at a 50% rate. So that's huge.
Yeah, LeBron and Kyrie, I mean, we're talking about the best players on their team, but they are the X factors. Those two, along with JR, contributed for 82 points. Yeah. They combined for 82 points. That's why I'm kind of leaning towards Kevin Love coming off the bench a little bit more, because they need a spark off the bench. Yeah. They're just so top-heavy, and if those guys contribute and you get a little bit of bench production, are we going to find out whether he's starting or not? Come on, Trey. Give us
and
the news
do it,
already.
With the second unit is my question.
Yeah, that's exactly right. All right, final question here. It's pretty simple. What are those? Oh, my God. Under Armour released an all-new edition of Steph Curry's signature shoe. And, yeah, there they are. Mm. Lee, I feel like you would rock these.
Oh,
well, for sure.
You old man.
Yeah, they seem to be made for me. The old man going out cleaning the garden.
You know, the internet got to work. Look, we're not doing an edition of the meme team this week, but...
Close enough.
I think she's wearing two left shoes, though. Yeah. That's probably why she fell.
She fell, exactly. Yeah. ARP, yeah, okay, the old jokes continue. Mr. Rogers loves them. Very comfortable shoe.
Yeah.
Very comfortable shoe. But his brother, Seth Curry, he posted and tweeted along with it, "I thought I had him looking straight last week."
Yeah.
The mesh is what throws me off. It's too much.
Interesting shoe. All right, up next, Trey Kirby joins us live from Cleveland, where it looks as though he's just arrived. Yeah. Gee,
they know that's Trey.
In style. Back to the starters, there he is, Trey Kirby rocking Cleveland. Trey, first question, buddy, how was your day today?
Well, it was actually really great, Skeets, because by chance, Fast and Furious 8 happens to be filming two blocks from the arena here, which is basically a dream scenario for me. So I went over to the set, checked things out, got yelled at not to take any pictures, took them anyways. And here's a spoiler alert, I think there's gonna be some car crashes in this edition of Fast and Furious. That's like 20 cars piled up in the middle of a street, all with New York City plates. What does it mean? I guess we'll have to see what Vin Diesel gets up to.
Okay, I was gonna say you haven't seen Vin Diesel walking around yet.
No, that's my one golden goose I'm still chasing down.
Okay, good luck with that. All right, well, look, what's the latest with Kevin Love? Do we know whether he's been cleared to play in Game 4, whether he's starting? What's going on here?
Well, there was no update this morning at shoot-around, and ESPN's Dave McMenamin reported that he was going to be evaluated today at the game when he arrived pregame, which was basically when I was walking down to the court to get ready to talk to you guys. So my guess is they're back there evaluating him right now. He's got to pass some concussion protocol tests 24 hours after going through a workout, which he went through yesterday. So I guess we're still waiting to get an update from him on the concussion protocol, or as LeBron James called it today, total recall.
Oh, total recall. I like that. Well, look, the Warriors didn't look like the 73-win team in Game 3. You've been around them. Was there any sort of talk with this squad at shoot-around? Any major themes, any major key words that continually was coming up?
Well, the major thing was that they all were just realizing that they need to play so much harder than they did in Game 3 to compete in Game 4. Steve Kerr said it took him two possessions to realize that things weren't going to go well in Game 3. Draymond Green said multiple times that the Warriors got punked, called them soft a bunch of times. Steph said the same thing. And Klay Thompson yesterday said they were embarrassed by the way they played in Game 3. So I think they realized they blew a chance to go up 3-0, put the Cavs in a really bad spot. They had a golden opportunity. So I'm expecting a lot better effort from the Warriors, because it seems to me like they knew they messed up in Game 3.
Yeah, we'll find out soon enough. Well, look, before we let you go, a couple more things. We have to, as our resident soul man, get your opinion on the Steph Curry 2s.
He's already laughing.
What do you think of these, soul man?
Well, I don't think they're necessarily as bad as Twitter's making them seem, but they're too plain for a signature shoe for the signature athlete of the brand. The logo looks kind of silly, but I might get a pair for my dad. I think he would like them. But I'm going to go head out to the streets of Cleveland as soon as I'm done talking to you guys to see what Cavs fans think. And I think they're going to be brutal.
Yeah. I can't imagine Cavs fans will be kind to those shoes. Well, you've given us a couple great one-on-one interviews while you've been in Cleveland. You talked to Shumpert. You talked to Richard Jefferson about his Snapchat success. Who's next? Who do you have in store for us?
Well, I sat down with Andrew Bernstein the other day. He's been covering every NBA Finals and All-Star Game since 1983. The guy has taken pictures of basically every big name in the game. Magic, Shaq, Kobe, MJ, literally everybody. And somehow I convinced him to add my name to his list. You guys know I love fashion, so if I get a chance to arrive to a game, get a fist pound from a security guard and just get my Westbrook on, I'm loving it.
Oh my God.
Did he think you were Russ Bankston?
Yeah, exactly. Everybody's like, wow, look at Russ come in.
You'll be skipping the security guard fist bump like Kyle Lowry.
Yeah, oh my God. Okay, well, we can't wait for that to see the entire thing. Finally, before we let you go here, Trey, your challenge tonight. Using Snapchat, talking about Richard Jefferson there, using Snapchat, we want you to swap faces with as many NBA personalities as possible.
Hey, sounds great to me. I know I'm going to be able to get 3D. That guy loves Snapchat, so hopefully I'll be able to get in that green room and go crazy with Grant Hill, Steve Smith, Matt Weiner, maybe even Barkley. We'll see what happens.
Okay, well, good luck. That is your challenge, and he has accepted it. Great stuff, TK. We got to take a quick break, but when we return, inspired by LeBron's crazy oop, we're going to count down the top 10 dunks of the playoffs so far. Don't go anywhere. This will be fun. Welcome back to the Starters, inspired by LeBron's unbelievable oop in Game 3. We have decided to celebrate the top 10 dunks of the playoffs, presented by
Ciroc.
Oh, there's a whole lot of rims to be Ciroc'd
with. Oh yeah, every one of them. At number 10,
LeBron James versus the Raptors on the fast break. Just sort of.
The fast break reverse, like you very rarely see that.
Oh, this is pretty. This angle's pretty. Oh yeah, rock that baby to sleep.
At number 9, watch this Kawhi defensive vacuum, suck that up. Then Russ tries to get him from behind.
Yeah.
Oh. Kawhi ain't having it.
Yeah, punches it home.
That's beautiful.
The claw.
The claw. Yeah. Let's get the claw from behind. Yeah.
Oh, man. Nice. At number 8, Taz, help me out, man.
Iman Shumpert.
Oh, Shumpert.
Nice.
With the putback against the Hawks in the second round. Skies, that's when his hair was so high. Gotta go back to the high hair, Shump.
Yeah.
At number 7, 6'8", 250, flies by Damari Carroll in a tight space, and then the throwdown.
Are these the Cavs' top 10 plays of the playoffs? What's going on?
How quickly he got by him in the throwdown.
This is the one he Ciroc'd the ball.
Yeah.
is the
ball okay?
There it
Deflategate. Wow. Yeah. NBA Deflategate. Right, at number 6, Raptors, Heat, Josh Richardson goes around Biombo, okay? Not through him. He goes sort of around him.
Biombo has to toss Justice Winslow. Get out of the way.
Yeah, I got
to
block this. No,
he had some nice dunks in the playoffs, Richardson.
He's got some good hops.
At number 5, 2 Clipper dunks on Mason Plumlee. This is me first. This just looks cool.
Yeah, they'll love this slow-mo.
Near 7-footer. One dribble from the three-point line just gets way over top. And his teammate, Blake Griffin, goes lefty on Mason Plumlee.
That's old man Blake there.
When did this series happen? Like 8 months ago?
Yeah. Feels like it.
At number 4, Norman Powell's Superman dunk. This brought a country to its feet.
Yeah.
When the Raptors were rallying against the Pacers in the first round.
Almost a great Shaqton
moment
right there.
Oh, yeah.
Could have brought the country to his knees.
Yeah. Mike Goldfarb was like, oh, yeah, drop it.
At number 3, Al Horford makes the list. Al Horford, the big jam. Again, monstrous man, one dribble from the three-point line. Kevin Love gets in the way.
Tries to take the charge.
Unlucky, Kevin.
Yeah. Huge dunk. Yeah, Al can't believe it. At number 2, guys, revenge is a dunk. Best served bold. After getting kicked in the kiwis, Steven Adams gets revenge on Draymond Green by just putting him in the rim.
At number 1, this is the one. Game 3 of the NBA Finals. A great steal, gives it to Kyrie to get it back. Oh, what a huge, huge jam. Kyrie said, I was just throwing it up wherever because I wanted to see something special.
He got it.
And he did. Hold on, he's going to rise a little bit more and then throw it down.
Wow. I thought we were frozen on live TV for a second. It was just cool editing.
This man's plus 30. He's over 30. Still getting
up. Still getting up.
Unbelievable stuff. So there it is. Top 10 dunks of the playoffs so far. We should add still basketball to be played. After the jump, we'll recap Game 3's biggest storylines as we get ready for Game 4 in Believe Land. Don't go anywhere.
Let's see it one more time.
Okay. Game 4 of the NBA Finals tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern on ABC. It's our first Friday night finals game since 2003. Mm. Shout out to Kevin Pelton for that fact. Where you at, Schumann? But before we get to that, let us revisit the major storylines from the Cavs Game 3 victory.
At number 5, with Kevin Love forced to sit because of the progressive NBA concussion protocol, Richard Jefferson was placed in the starting lineup. RJ made it look like 0-3, his last finals appearance. He filled in admirably. 9, 8, and 2 steals. Actually, he didn't hit a 3 in that 0-3 series. RJ's getting better. At number 4, it's home momentum. Cavs went back to Ohio and rode the Believe Land wave. Got out to a 19-4 start, looking far more energized than at any point in this series, and they stayed undefeated at home this postseason. Number 3, LeBron, Kyrie, JR with the best game of the finals. Simply put, Cavs' best scorers had their best games. LeBron found the jumper. He had 32. Kyrie found the shaken and the bacon. He had 30. JR found his groove, dropping 20. Yeah, he's feeling it. On the other side, the Warriors' best scorers couldn't find it at all. They combined for 29 points in a wire-to-wire win for Cleveland. Steph Curry, he did have a 13-point third quarter. Will that carry over? Tonight, we shall find out. And at number 1, this is the moment people will remember from Game 3. The King crowned the Warriors with this absurd dunk. This was the exclamation point of the dominant win. Blowouts. Just trading blowouts in this series,
yeah,
and that's the exclamation point. Yeah, I think it's over. I think it's over.
I've been praying to the basketball gods all day for a close game, and I think we get it tonight. I think they will listen to my prayers. We haven't seen both of these teams play their best basketball on the same night.
No.
It feels like we're due. Who do you think takes this game tonight, Lee?
I think the Warriors are just going to be much more focused from the start. I think they take it 3-1.
Yeah, I think the blowout might have been a bit of a disservice to Cleveland, you know, because they will be awake.
Right. Could happen. All right, guys, a reminder here. Set your DVRs tomorrow night, 9 p.m. Eastern on NBA TV for another episode of Finals Film Room. Show breaks down the in-game strategies, play calls, trends, and game action from Game 4. We also recorded our drop podcast yesterday morning, hour and a half long. You can catch that on iTunes, Google Play Music. We got it up on our website.
90 minutes before tip. Just do it.
Perfectly. Just put it on right now. So that's it for us. You're headed to the Bay for Game 5 of the weekend. Have a blast, and we'll see you on Monday.
All right, folks. Thank you so much for joining us. And remember, it's not how you leave. It's how you arrive.
Race the weekend, people. Enjoy the game tonight.